Welcome to the final day of Journalism Week. I hope you've enjoyed it so far. Today is today. The whole day is being sponsored by the RTS. That's the Royal Television Society. And I'm just speaking to you a little bit to let you know about it because I'm the vice chair of the Yorkshire Centre. So the good thing for you to know, and I think a theme actually that's come out from this week is for you guys to grab all the opportunities that come your way. And one of them is joining the RTS. So the good news is it's free for students. So you should really think about joining because you've got nothing to lose, okay? We do a lot of events. There's master classes that you can join in on, program awards. There's some student awards in February, which I'd like to go to and take a group with me if I can. It's too late to enter the awards for this year, but it would give you an opportunity to see what sort of things win awards, and obviously that would look fantastic on CV. There's also on December the 6th, the Christmas quiz. So if anyone is keen to answer a few questions about television, why don't you form a group and join in? It's in the center of Leeds. We have a few drinks, it's quite fun. So if you're interested in that, come along to that. And of course the program awards, which is kind of the big thing in June, sort of black tie event that we all go to. So have a real good think about that. It's a really good thing to get into, to network, to learn some names, to say that you're part of an organization already before you graduate. And it may lead to some things that will be beneficial to you for the rest of your lives and your careers. Okay, I'll hand you over now to Dean.
Okay. Oh well, I'd just like to add my thanks to Catherine's. You guys have been great all week. It's day four of Journalism Week, and every year we say exactly the same thing. The time just goes like that. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have. Please don't forget, at the end of today, you are welcome to join us in the lounge for a refreshment on behalf of the department. And let me tell you, you need to get your hands on anything that you get for free these days. So if there's a drinks token involved, see one of us, okay? But before then, of course, we've got the small matter of a range of different speakers. And I'm delighted to say that Phil Hay has joined us today. Many of you probably follow him on Twitter. You probably read his stuff in the Yorkshire Evening Post as well. He's a chief football writer, of course, and he covers Leeds United, a club that really needs no introduction. It's an exciting job. It's one that many of you probably aspire to as well. And just to let you know, Phil's taken his time out this morning to come and see us, and immediately afterwards he's going to be going back to Thorpe Arch to hear what Gary Monk has got to say ahead of Sunday's big game against Newcastle United. So it's great that working journalists take their time out to speak to us. So I'm delighted to announce Phil Hay. Thank you.
Thank you.
It is a hard life off up to interview Gary Monk after this. I'm sure I'll cope. But listen, thanks to everybody for coming out today on what is a pretty bleak morning. I'm no public speaker, and this feels a bit like the State of the Union address, but I'm here to speak to you today about local journalism, about my job covering Leeds United as chief football writer for the Yorkshire Evening Post, and also in a bit more depth about the industry that many of you will be going into when you graduate next year or a little further down the line. Local journalism and the media industry in general has changed beyond all recognition from the days when I was studying at the University of Sheffield and graduating in 2001. In that period, we've seen a huge shift from the classic formats of print and broadcast journalism to an online era, and an era with more varieties of media than we've ever seen before. As an industry, and particularly thinking of newspapers, we now operate without the sort of rigid deadlines or the fixation on deadlines, which I dealt with in my early years at the Yorkshire Evening Post. And journalists now publish all hours, more often than not there and then when a story comes to them. The traditional restrictions that I knew when I first joined the Evening Post have gone completely or almost completely. And I honestly couldn't have foreseen that 15 years ago when I left university in Sheffield. I first went to the Yorkshire Evening Post in 2004 as a general sports reporter, and back then our shifts on the sports desk started at 6:30 in the morning to meet a first print deadline of half past nine. At that time, the paper had fully six editions, which ran right through the morning into early afternoon. And the last, which is now sadly defunct, but the Leeds City edition, went to press at around 1:30 in the afternoon. After that deadline and before the advent of newspaper websites, we had no scope at all for breaking any stories or publishing anything until the papers began to print again the next day. The advantage for us in that situation was that the Nationals printed overnight, so we were able to beat them to stories or to move on stories that they'd published that morning. But essentially now the situation has changed and the landscape is completely different. These days, the Evening Post has only one print edition, which goes at around about 10:30 at night. Now, that deadline is slightly flexible, particularly on nights when Leeds United play. If we use the example of the League Cup game against Norwich last month, which went to extra time and penalties, on that evening, the paper went to bed around about midnight, simply to allow us to get all the coverage in. But generally speaking, at 10:30 at night, a one and only edition will go to bed and will come out the next morning. And even though the Evening Post is still branded as an evening newspaper, it's not in the traditional sense that we all understood. And if truth be told, that there is almost no such thing as an evening newspaper now. Most local newspapers print overnight. Most have cut their editions down to one. Some still have a couple, but certainly none still have, or very few still have, the six or seven that we had when I joined the Evening Post in 2004. You can understand why that is when you realise that on a daily basis more people read the YEP's website than read the print newspaper. And the ironic thing about that is that the print newspaper still generates more money. We still get more income from advertising revenue on the print side than we do from advertising and other sources of income online. And for that reason, you can understand why in the industry, local newspapers are struggling so much to cope with a shift from print journalism to online journalism, and are struggling to come up with a really effective strategy, not only for producing good journalism online, but also for making money at the same time. When I started at the Evening Post, it was simply a newspaper, a very good newspaper, but no more than that. These days, we are all things to all men. We have video content, we have audio content, social media content, and all of that alongside the bread and butter of written articles, which, in all honesty, will never disappear, but now make up a much smaller part of what is on our website and is online. As I said earlier, my own path to the Evening Post began at the University of Sheffield, where I was an undergraduate between 1998 and 2001. The course there was Journalism Studies, which still runs today, and no doubt has changed slightly, but I still think we'll have the same nuts and bolts to it. And back then, you could have divided the students into four types. You had those who wanted to go into newspaper journalism, those who wanted to go into radio journalism, those who wanted to go into television broadcasting, and I guess like any university course, those who graduated with no interest in going into journalism at all. At that time, there was no Twitter, there was no Facebook, there was no Instagram, there was no real audience for online journalism at all. As it happened, my very first job in 2001 was as a Football League reporter with the Press Association, and parts of that did involve uploading stories to what was a very primitive website, but it had a very small profile, attracted very few hits, and was of no real value to the company. I would say it took really until the middle of the 2000s for media organisations to properly attack the internet, and certainly at the YEP, we had no real digital focus. We didn't adopt one until around about 2007, 2008, which makes you realise how recently that shift came, but also makes you realise how much of a change there has been in a small period of time. And even 8 years ago, it's hard to have thought then what the landscape would look like now. But now, 8 years on, it's very difficult to imagine any newspaper operating without a website, and quite frankly, no paper or very few papers would be able to survive in that way. When I graduated, and when you applied for jobs at a newspaper, you would typically apply to be a sub-editor or a reporter. Those were the two jobs that you would go for. Today, if you look at the jobs market, if you look at any local paper, you'll find positions for social media editors, heads of audience, multimedia journalists, other positions of that ilk. Sub-editors like Dean was at the Independent. The old hands who used to lay out the pages are something of a dying breed and an endangered species, and they're the people who have suffered most from the cuts that have come in local journalism. Trinity Mirror, who own the Liverpool Echo, the Manchester Evening News, the Chronicle in Newcastle, they recently have thrown huge amounts of cash at developing online digital teams to cover their local football clubs. So Liverpool and Everton for the Echo, Manchester United and City for them for the Evening News, and Newcastle predominantly for the Chronicle. This has happened to such an extent that the Newcastle Chronicle now devote more resources to covering Sunderland Football Club than the Johnston Press-owned Sunderland Echo, which sounds counterintuitive and sounds extremely strange. And if that comes as a surprise, then it should, because if you know Newcastle, you know that there is very little interest in their traditional patch for knowing about Sunderland Football Club. But the internet now gives newspapers like the Chronicle, like the Evening Post, so much more reach, so much of a bigger audience to tap into. And essentially, they've seen Sunderland as a new market to get into, a new market to exploit, and a new market to pull hits from. And that is why they now devote at least two members of staff to every game that Sunderland play. And perhaps a better example of a paper seeking broader horizons is the Daily Record in Glasgow. You probably won't have picked up on this, but very recently they began running increased amounts of coverage of Manchester United. And to say that Manchester United are outside the Record's typical catchment area would be a big understatement. The Record has always focused heavily on the Old Firm, with a sprinkling of other Scottish football roundabout. But very little of the copy about Manchester United is used in the newspaper. It's predominantly an online offering, which bypasses their traditional reader, bypasses the Rangers and the Celtic fan, and rightly or wrongly taps into the really huge global interest that the Manchester United have. And I'm sorry for offending anybody who doesn't want to hear that. On the face of it, you'd say that that's a peculiar state of affairs, and again, I would certainly agree, but there is some logic to it, and it essentially is that newspapers and sports desks are trying harder and harder to be more creative and more inventive about ways of driving traffic and attracting hits to their website. And if you're wondering why the Daily Record do that, ask yourself why it is that the Mail Online runs so much coverage of Barcelona and Real Madrid, an English website paying so much attention to Spanish football and foreign football. As a completely different example, 10 years ago, I don't think the Sun newspaper would ever have touched WWE wrestling. I think they'd have considered it a complete joke. But if you look at their Twitter feed now, on a daily basis, wrestling is on there regularly. It's covered day to day. And it's covered for one good reason, because wrestling, for better or worse, has a massive audience and an audience across the world. And that's all the motivation that the Sun needs to tap into that and to take a piece of the market. In the years when the websites, newspaper websites, were first developing, and at the Evening Post you'd be talking 2008, it was taken as read that stories would run in the newspaper first and online second, essentially so that the important product, the product that sold, the product that people went to first, was the newspaper. And there was a very strict pecking order in that respect. But today there's very little which doesn't appear online before it appears in the paper. That's true of the Evening Post, as it is not only of most local newspapers, but also of an awful lot of nationals these days. And you'll also find a lot more content online than you take Leeds United as an example. More Leeds United content online on the YEP's website day to day than you'll find in the newspaper. If we at the Evening Post pick up a story about a transfer at Ellen Road, or a sacking, or a player signing a new contract, anything newsworthy, that copy will go on the website immediately. You'll get more analysis later in the paper the following day. You get more extensive coverage of that situation and what's happened. But we would never ever think of holding a story back now for the following day. It isn't prudent, and it's not the done thing. We tweet live from pre-match press conferences, as we'll do this afternoon before the game against Newcastle on Sunday. And we have coverage of these press conferences online hours before it appears on the paper. If you look at our website later today, you'll see two or three quotes pieces from Gary Monk later. Those will then appear in the paper tomorrow, but essentially the first hit will come on the website. We are not unique like that. Everybody else does it. And whether you agree with it or not, it is the way that journalism has gone. There is obviously a long-standing argument about whether or not this is the right strategy for newspapers. And if I'm being honest, or even whether it's financially sustainable, if I'm being honest, I don't think anybody has a definitive answer to that. But in many ways, the discussion is moot. It is the way the industry has gone, and it's impossible for anybody to roll back from that now. And again, to take the Yorkshire Evening Post as an example, when people are used to getting the coverage of Leeds United for free, at no cost, it's never going to be easy to persuade them to pay for it. We've never had a paywall at the Yorkshire Evening Post, and as far as I'm aware, to the best of my knowledge, there's no plan to charge readers for any content either. You'll probably know that the Murdoch papers established paywalls a few years ago. The Sun have already given up on theirs, and the reason for that is that hits generate advertising income, and paywalls inevitably reduce the number of people who are going to your website. There are certain outlets like The Guardian and The Daily Mail who have a big enough budget to expand endlessly at no cost to the reader. But locally, papers like The Evening Post and others across the country, there simply is nothing like the same budget to do that. To give you a little bit more insight into my background and how I came to come to The Evening Post, as I said earlier, I studied at the University of Sheffield and I graduated 15 years ago, which seems like a hell of a long time ago, and I did come in here and laugh at how young everybody looks, bless you all. But for all that journalism has changed and for all that I imagine there are differences with this course to the course that I studied, there will still be things that are very similar, things that are still as fundamentally important to you as they were to me back in 2001. For example, I don't think the digital shift has at all diminished the importance of media law. And to be frank, given the speed and the reach of online coverage these days, I think a clear understanding of media law is more important now than it's ever been. Never ever make the mistake of thinking you won't or can't be sued for something you say or do on Twitter, because the opposite is true, and that is true of all social media formats. As an aside, I read a few weeks ago that the NCTJ are planning to make shorthand optional as part of their courses, planning to give people the choice of whether to do it or not. I would suggest that no one here, certainly no one who's thinking of getting into newspaper journalism, but nobody who's getting into any form of journalism, thinks of shorthand as an optional skill. It's incredibly useful and a very crucial fallback for situations where you either can't record a conversation or you don't have the chance to turn the dictaphone on. In his time as chairman at Leeds United, I interviewed Ken Bates countless times for my sins. And he never once allowed those interviews to be recorded. Why he didn't, I don't know. He never gave a reason, but he would simply say when he sat down, no tapes, notes only. And without shorthand, I'd never have had any accurate record of that conversation at all. It would have been almost impossible to have written those interviews into any form of reliable article. Okay, fair enough. So much these days is recorded. This has been recorded. You could find an audio file online of this tomorrow and take the quotes down. But it's also an advantage to be able to produce a story without first having to listen back through 20 minutes of Gary Monk talking at a press conference. The Evening Post expect us to tweet relevant quotes immediately after pre-match pressers, post-match pressers. And they also expect us to upload reaction pieces as quickly as possible and as quickly as other news outlets are. And take it from me, picking lines out of shorthand, as much as shorthand is a bind to learn, is considerably easier than trawling through a very long audio file. Although in truth, a belts and braces approach of shorthand and audio is never a bad idea, because you can never have too much cover in that respect. During my degree in Sheffield, we focused a lot on news reporting. It wasn't a sports journalism degree. So we did council reporting, we did court reporting, we did investigative journalism as well. But I always wanted to be a football writer. And I was fortunate in my first year that a week of work experience with the Press Association's sports desk led to casual shifts of weekly football reporting in years 2 and 3, and ultimately led to the offer of a full-time job with PA when I graduated in 2001. I can't stress enough the importance of doing as much work experience as you can, of getting your foot in the door of anywhere that will give you the opportunity to work for a week to see what proper sports reporting is like, proper journalism is like. It goes without saying, and you'll all know this, that the industry, jobs-wise, is more competitive than ever these days. Is perhaps more constricted than ever, certainly on the newspaper front. Our newspaper is no different to many others. We've had substantial staff cuts in that period. We've had changes to the structure of the news desk, changes to the amount of staff we need in certain areas, which is why so many sub-editors have departed. But having your foot in the door anywhere is a definite advantage, or at the very least a potential advantage. It gives you the understanding of how journalists work, what they do, and what a day-to-day job is like for a professional reporter. At the YEP, we've had countless students from Leeds Trinity come to us. We run weekly work experience placements through the year, and anyone here who would like to come is more than welcome to approach us, to email me and to come and see what we do. Needless to say, you won't be coming home and away with Leeds United, but you will be doing proper sports reporting, and let's be honest, nobody ever starts out doing exactly what they want to do, and I certainly didn't. For those of you that know anything about the Press Association, they're pretty much in the business of supplying copy to other media outlets to use. So at PA Sport, my first job, I had a fairly broad remit. Football League reporting to start with. I produced interviews for sports magazines that the Press Association was contracted to publish. I supplied weekly betting copy for the Daily Star, which again was subcontracted to PA. In that period, I also helped to launch the in-house magazine of the Professional Footballers Association, the Players Union, essentially a magazine that's sent out to all of their members once a month. But from a very early stage, I wanted the job of doing day-to-day coverage of a big football club for a good local newspaper. So in 2004, I took the offer from the YEP to become a general sports writer with them. And 2 years later, the paper's chief football writer at the time, some of you will probably have heard of him, Paul Dews, went to become the media manager at Leeds United, and I was lucky enough to be given his job. So 10 years on, 700 games later, I'm still in that post and still looking for a season in the Premier League. Although given the way Leeds are going on at the moment, perhaps it's finally on the way. Fingers crossed. So the remit of my job as chief football writer is to be across everything and anything that goes on at Elland Road. And as much as you might think that covering games is a big part of the job, in actual fact, it's a fairly small part of what you're committed to doing week to week. The paper expect you to have good enough, wide enough contacts to pick up stories, to accurately follow up stories written by other papers, to produce relevant features and articles day after day for all but 2 or 3 days of the year when the newspaper doesn't print. I honestly don't think there are any more, or many more, newsworthy clubs in England than Leeds United. And one of my predecessors, and the legendary Don Waters, who had the pleasure of covering the Don Revy era, he once told me that I'd never be short of a story at Elland Road, and he really wasn't wrong. In 10 years, I've seen 2 takeovers, 2 playoff finals, 1 administration, 1 relegation, 1 promotion, 1 unprecedented 15-point deduction, 12 different managers or head coaches, the arrival, departure of scores of players from the club, 1 ownership ban for Massimo Cellino, partridge in a pear tree, all that sort of stuff. And that's honestly without touching on the sort of day-to-day chaos that's defined the club for most of the past decade. I know that the journalism course here concentrates in part on the business side of football and the business side of sport, and that will be a very, very valuable module for you. Something we never had in Sheffield, and I wish we had. I wish they'd touched on that. It would have been something that I would have benefited from. Because a lot of what you'll deal with as a football writer is really the domain and the remit of a traditional business journalist. And I've come to learn more about annual accounts and insolvency practice than I ever expected to need to know, or in all honesty, than I ever really wanted to know. But I'd have been very lost at times without that understanding, particularly in the summer of 2007 when Leeds were in complete disarray and in insolvency. It was very much a learning curve, but I think a lot of you will benefit from the fact that you will go into situations like that and you'll go into stories like that with some understanding of at least what is going on. So in my role, I travel home and away to every single first team game, on top of covering occasional development squad fixtures, youth team matches, and so on. We also cover all of the club's pre-season tours abroad, or at least most of which are abroad. We have had less sparkling ones like Falkirk and Motherwell. But more often than not, we do get to go to Slovenia, to Slovakia, to Dublin, as it was this summer. The job has taken me, I would say, to all but 10 of the 92 grounds in the Premier League and the Football League, and also to numerous foreign countries. And if you're into football, which I know a lot of you will be, it is genuinely fascinating and a treat to be able to see at close hand how the game works, how the game actually works, how it really works, what it's like behind the scenes, and also to get to understand the psyche of players and managers, albeit in a way which will occasionally take off the magic and will take off the Roy of the Rovers brand that football likes to paint with itself. If you don't know already, you'll find that football can be cynical, can be underhand, it is full of egos, and it does contain its share of dislikable characters. But to my mind, there's very little in British society which captivates attention in the way that football does. And some of what you cover, you will absolutely never forget. I mean, of all the things I've written about, I always single out Mad Friday, the night in 2014 when Massimo Cellino agreed his takeover and sacked Brian McDermott and lost 2 club sponsors, as a day like no other I've ever seen. And I was still writing about that at 2 o'clock in the morning. And that story rolled on all weekend. There really is no such thing as set hours for a football writer. And given that Chileno tends not to surface until lunchtime anyway, his time zone is slightly different to a 9-to-5 shift. Anybody at all can write about football. And that is true now more than ever because of the access that the internet gives people to blogs, to their own websites. If you go online any day this afternoon, you'll find countless blogs about Leeds United, but countless general football blogs as well, which cover anything about Leeds United, simply because having the club's name in a headline will encourage people to click on the link. Some of it's good, some of it's a waste of space, and some of it is borderline plagiarism. And as someone once said to me right at the start, one of the keys to good football writing is to be informed about your subject and to be informed about the club that you're covering, to make sure that you're informed by speaking to everybody and anyone connected to the club that you're writing about. It's the only way that you can find out what's really going on at a football club, as opposed to what you think is going on. The old sports editor of the News of the World before its demise, Paul McCarthy, he used to talk about what he called top-of-the-head bollocks. And what he meant by that was articles that simply involved people sitting down and writing whatever was in their head, regardless of whether it had any merit to it. Now, as he always said, everybody's entitled to an opinion, everybody's entitled to express it, and everybody has a view on football. But if you're not around the club, if you're not speaking to people at the club, if you're not trying to find out what's going on, it's very difficult, stroke impossible, to offer any real insight into what's actually happening. A knowledge of what is going on helps you to be confident in your writing and confident in your opinions, confident in how you see things. It lets you see the bigger picture of what's happening at somewhere like Leeds United. If I use Sam Byram as a quick example, last season, Leeds and Chileno let it be known that Byram was refusing to sign a new contract at the club. And at face value, you might have seen that as grounds for criticism of him. But what we found out subsequently was that Byram was being asked to take a pay cut. Being asked to take a pay cut by the club despite being supposedly one of the better youngsters, one of their more talented prospects. And suddenly when you discover something like that, your reading of the situation, your understanding of it, or your perception of it changes. And so does your approach to writing about it. So phone people, speak to people as much as you can, keep in touch with people and ask questions. Don't always take what you're told at face value. And remember, if it sounds like a club are spinning a tail, the chances are they probably are. On top of that, keep a note of every contact you get because you'll never know whose number you'll need or when you might need it. It is obviously valuable. It's very important as a football writer to have a good relationship with managers, with players, with club officials, with officials at the Football Association, the Football League, with agents, with officials at rival clubs. But it's certainly not your job to be friends with them. You're there to write about them, not for them, and there is a big difference. But equally, everything you write should be balanced. Nothing you write should ever be personal. You'll fall out with people, and you'll upset people. I know that more than most. You're entitled to do that, but equally, people are entitled to criticise what you write. Over the years, I've had run-ins, countless run-ins, with people like Ken Bates, Massimo Cellino, Dennis Wise, the list goes on. And at times, they would accuse me or accuse the paper of overly negative reporting or of unfair reporting. And my stance has always been that if you look at what's gone on at Leeds United over the past decade, it would be very difficult for the Evening Post or any other local paper to paint the club in a particularly positive light. And I don't think any independent reporter should ever do that. There was a time going back not so very long when clubs and newspapers worked hand in hand, or essentially worked hand in hand. But these days, supporters expect you to scrutinise a club as closely as you can. And to be perfectly honest, social media and the attention on journalists means that there's more scrutiny of your coverage than ever before as well. You can't avoid difficult stories. You can't be seen to be a mouthpiece for a club. And when it comes to football clubs are big enough and often rich enough to look after themselves. At times, they'll ask you not to run stories. They'll ask you to delay them or to walk them down. You should never do that without a good reason. And the fact that the story might embarrass somebody or upset somebody is not necessarily a good reason. To take Massimo Cellino as an example, some people do say that the Evening Post have been too hard on him. But the question I'd ask in return is, don't Cellino's methods deserve scrutiny? And if the local media aren't scrutinising his management, who will? Because of all the clubs in England, Leeds United probably know more than most the consequences of poor ownership. And to be perfectly honest, in 10 years, I've seen many of them, if not all. In general, a football writer's existence is a strange one. And I honestly don't mean that as a complaint. But you'll spend hours on the road every week. My car's mileage at the moment is just under 140,000, and there are bits dropping off it all over the place. You'll spend days of your life sitting and waiting for press conferences or waiting for interviewees to turn up. I once waited at Thorpe Arch for more than 5 hours to interview Jonathan Woodgate after he came back from Real Madrid for a bit of physio treatment with the old physio Dave Hancock up there. And last year I spent fully 4 months trying to get a phone number for Tony Yeboah to do an article on the 20th anniversary of his famous goal against Liverpool in 1995. And when I finally got hold of him, he was on the reception desk of the hotel that he owns and runs in Ghana. So 4 months of chasing for a 30-minute interview, but absolutely worth the effort for the article that came out of it. You'll turn up to interview players on time, and you'll find that they've already gone home, even though you've got an empty page to fill tomorrow. You'll drive 500 miles in the space of 12 hours. You get back from Brighton at 3 in the morning, and you'll get up at 9 o'clock that same morning to start again. For 10 months out of 12, you'll devote every weekend to your job. You'll be at risk of people suing you. We've been sued by Ken Bates as a paper. I was threatened at least twice with legal action by GFH and David Haig, although they never delivered on that. And you'll be at risk of clubs banning you. Bates banned us twice during his time as chairman, and I always got the feeling we'd like to have banned us a hell of a lot more. You'll read articles by other people that you wish you'd written yourself, and you'll have days where you miss stories that you know you should have picked up. But equally, you'll have days where everything goes right, where you set the agenda, and where the job satisfaction is absolute. And you'll have days where your persistence in chasing stories pays off. You'll be covering something that thousands of people are interested in and want to know about. It's a fantastic job and a great adventure. You'll pick up stories or you'll come away with memories, like the time we accidentally blew up the electrics in a bar in northern Slovakia, or the time we had to pay off the traffic police in Slovenia in 2013. Well, that's for another time. Just don't let anybody tell you that the job's easy, and don't expect to make a fortune doing it. If you want to make money, I suggest you go into banking. My sister-in-law is 10 years younger than me and about 5 times as rich. But I don't think I'd trade covering Leeds United for the pleasure of chasing money launderers around. So just to finish, I want to talk to you a bit about your future job prospects and where you might go next, because I remember being your age and I remember sitting listening to people like me and wondering how it is you go from university to doing the job of a football writer or television broadcasting or anything like that. There is no question that the media industry is in a bad way or in a difficult way in some respects, and in certain fields in particular. Local newspapers, more than any, and the YP is no different, have felt the pinch. And most are struggling still to come to terms with the reality of ever-decreasing print sales, which, if we're being honest, is a trend which now is never going to reverse. It is set in stone. There are jobs in journalism. There are plenty of jobs in sports journalism, but they're not endless. So do everything you can to make yourself stand out and be open to every single aspect of journalism. I obviously write thousands of words every week, but on top of that, we now do podcasts, we do video diaries, we do blogs, we do Facebook Live events, and so on. So try not to pigeonhole yourself and think of yourself as a reporter or a journalist who simply writes. And really don't waste any time thinking about the merits of new media. You're better off embracing it because it's there and it's what everybody's doing. As I said earlier, take every and any worthwhile opportunity of work experience. And if any of you do want to come to the Evening Post, you know where I am. You can find my email address easily enough. Qualifications matter, and the course you're doing here will stand you in excellent stead going forward. But a book of cuttings, published articles, will give you a genuine leg up in any interview that you go to. Work experience and cuttings might go further than that and might land you a job without even needing to go through an interview. And as much as you'll all want to do football or you all want to do sports journalism, don't be adverse to taking a job in news if it's a means of getting into the industry. Over the years, some truly excellent football writers started out as news journalists, news reporters. And reporting in news does give you a very good nose for a story. It won't harm your writing at all, and if anything, it will enhance it. But in the meantime, read as much sports writing as you can, newspapers, magazines, anything else. Identify the styles that you like and the styles that you don't. Let your own style develop while taking ideas from other people and people who are more experienced. Be innovative in what you do and innovative in your ideas. If you wanted to find out what makes Pontus Jansson tick, is it better to speak to him and ask him, or is it better to speak to people who grew up with him, people who coached him at other clubs, people who worked with him in the national team? The chances are it's probably the latter. And starting from now, be as professional as you can possibly be. You might not be in employment at this stage, but you will be before long. And when you are, your Facebook and your Twitter accounts are there to be scrutinised. There was a story very recently, and if you go online, you can read all about it, of a reporter who joined the Sunderland Echo as their Sunderland FC writer. And he came from a newspaper in Dundee, but he was a native of Newcastle, and he was a Newcastle fan. And it took Sunderland supporters a couple of days to dig out some very old Facebook posts in which he'd been extremely derogatory about Sunderland, the club and the city. Now, he printed a very long apology online. I employ what I think will become known as the Andre Gray defence of saying he was a very different person back then. But the fallout and the criticism was so severe that the Sunderland Echo took him off the Sunderland job without him covering the game. So in essence, he lost the Premier League reporting job without surviving for a week on the basis of some Facebook posts which were more than 6 years old. It's a very, very good lesson to heed. And if any of you do have incriminating evidence on your Facebook or social media accounts, I strongly suggest that you clean them up. Social media does encourage sort of spur of the moment reactions, but it is risky and it does have consequences. And as far as social media is concerned, bear in mind that Facebook, Twitter, blogs will never replace proper journalists doing proper journalism. That's what you're training for here. It's what you should all aspire to. And I don't doubt that in years to come, I'll be reading insightful articles written by people who are in this room now. The training here really is worth its weight in gold. And going forward, I do wish you all the best. So thank you very much for listening. And any questions you've got, I'll happily answer. Do you mean in terms of producing the article? Video is your strongest aspect to go with a written article. And it differs from club to club. Leeds United allow people who pay to cover them, like Radio Leeds, like Radio Yorkshire, to take videos of their press conferences. The likes of ourselves who don't pay to cover, we are not allowed to use video content of their press conferences because they have LUTV, they have their own in-house station. So we tend, alongside that, we tend to do what would be called in broadcasting circles is talking head videos. So one of our reporters would interview me for thoughts on the game coming up, thoughts on the press conference, any issues arising from it. But essentially these days, we have the written article, we have video content with it. It tweets, it goes on Facebook pages, it goes across a broad spectrum. But the nuts and bolts of the press conference, if you don't have video footage to fall back on, is still your written copy. So as a written journalist, that is still your priority.
You talked about being banned from books and campaigns and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Massimo, actually, you know, recently, did you take a standpoint on the Time to Go Massimo thing? There was a bit of a fallout from the club.
We've never been banned as such by Chelino, although for the best part of 2 years, I dealt very closely with him, sort of day to day, week to week, was in touch. Our relationship has broken down to the extent where we don't speak anymore. And the reason for that is that we've taken a very hard line on him, hard line on his management of the club. And that is an inevitable consequence of it. It's unfortunate to lose contacts, but losing a contact is never a reason to not write what you should write. Well, absolutely. And obviously, he will see things differently to how we see it. We take our own view on that. But it's unrealistic to expect that anybody you're highly critical of is going to engage with you to any great extent. So we knew that would be a consequence of it, but it, from our point of view, it had to be done. That's pretty much always been my stance on Chelino, that I found it difficult to see how his methods of management and the way that he runs the club would allow them to progress. Although I have to say that in the past 3 or 4 months, our opinion on that has softened slightly. And I think the big difference this season is that the people he's put in position, like the chief executive, Ben Mansford, but probably more to the point, Gary Monk, have actually been allowed to do their jobs without too much interaction from him and without too much interference. I don't think Monk has anything like the same amount of communication with Chelino that the previous head coaches have had. And for whatever reason, whether the penny's dropped, although as everybody will know, there is a lot of chatter about impending takeover at the moment, he seems to have realised that him in a back seat, him out of the way is helpful and avoids the disruption that was really prevalent right from the start when he took over through to the end of last season. So to look at the situation now, I don't think it's impossible that the club could get promoted under him. And if the club do get promoted, then the income they'll get when they go into the Premier League, the television broadcast income in particular, means that their ability to develop will be tenfold. But I think in terms of moving forward particularly quickly, I think there are other people who could do that better. Yes. Well, Ian Hislop at Private Eye used to say the first thing you should do with any writ you receive is throw it in the bin, but obviously they have a much bigger legal bill or legal team than we do. I've never been sued directly, and the threats from David Haig and GFH never came to anything, and I think the reason they didn't come to anything was because there was nothing libelous in the pieces we'd written. They were simply critical of their management and critical of aspects of their management. So obviously it's not a nice situation, it's a pressurised situation, but you do have the protection of your newspaper who will look after you in those circumstances. I would assume that the National Union of Journalists will still be there when you all graduate, and I would recommend that you join them, because equally they will give you legal protection for what you write, and you do need that because people are litigious. Ken Bates was extremely litigious. As I say, he did sue us in 2006, and to be perfectly frank, he won that case. So it's not easy to deal with. It is a pitfall. It is a risk, but it very much comes with the job. I don't think so. It's not a secret that Chelino and Radrizzani, Andrea Radrizzani, the Italian businessman who's been linked with this takeover, have been speaking. We pictured them at two games in the summer, and there's been no suggestion that talks haven't been taking place. That, like with many takeovers at Leeds or proposed takeovers, we're at the point now where it either happens or it doesn't, and reporting the fact that they're talking is almost immaterial because it's been going on for such a period of time now that if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, then it disappears and we carry on. So there's certainly some basis to it, but whether it's going to lead to anything, that I think is very much in Chelino's hands, and he's a highly unpredictable guy. You can never second guess him.
Technology in sports constantly changing. Do you think it could have a positive impact on football and other sports?
I don't think whether it's going to have a positive impact or not is really relevant. As we've seen in journalism, you can't avoid technology. You have to embrace it, and it will keep developing. I know at the Evening Post there was a lot of resistance, and I was the same as anybody else to Facebook, to Twitter. There was huge resistance to the idea that stories might go online before they go in the newspaper because, as I said in the talk, newspapers still earn the bulk, or our newspaper still earns the bulk of its income from print revenue, from print advertising. But if you can't beat them, join them. And it goes without saying that in 5-10 years' time, newspapers will have shrunk to a point where they no longer have enough relevance to support a title like the Evening Post. You're going to have a big online presence. And the same is true of football as an industry. It can't avoid things like live streaming. It can't pretend that it doesn't exist. It can't even really manage it because it's too wide and it's too prevalent to be able to keep on top of. So football and technology will develop at a rapid rate, and whether it's good or not, that will happen one way or the other.
Just after the Huddersfield Town League derby, Gary Monk walked away from Adam Coe. Did he come and I'm guessing he came up and you interviewed him after then? What? Firstly, knowing that he walked away from a radio interview, what was your way of thinking about, well, how am I going to tackle him here?
In the press room that we're in, we can't hear the radio interviews. So when he came up to the press conference, we weren't aware that had gone on. We hadn't seen any tweets. The audio of the file hadn't been hadn't been tweeted, hadn't been published by the BBC, and nobody had been in touch to tell us that that had gone on. And his demeanour in the press conference was completely different to how he was with Adam. And I think that the simple reason for that was that he regretted doing what he did with Adam. And I think it was spur of the moment stuff. And it sounds worse in live broadcast. It shocks people to hear that. But to be perfectly honest, it happens an awful lot more than you'd realise. And you have a lot of press conferences where it's tetchy or it's tense or it's a bit offhand. But we had a press conference on the Monday before the Blackburn game, the following Tuesday. And we sat and we spoke with Gary off the record predominantly after the press conference. And he did really say himself that he hadn't meant to do that, that he shouldn't have done it. And I think by the time he'd gone from the tunnel up the steps and into the West Stand, I think he probably realised that himself. But we would never pull him up, I don't think, on being tetchy with another journalist. I think you'd really pull him up on the issues he's been asked about. He was frustrated, don't get me wrong, you know.
But I'm thinking, I thought he would have taken that anger of just walking away from both to take it into the TV guys as well, but...
No, I think the opposite was, he's a very level-headed guy, is Gary Monk, and I think the reality was that he realised between that and the press conference that he shouldn't have done it, and it's not really his style. You won't find a huge number of interviews, even when he was under huge pressure at Swansea. He didn't tend to crack like that. He was very good at keeping a poker face and saying what had to be said. But as I say, we would never ask him about why he was being difficult with another journalist, but we would certainly have asked him the same questions, i.e., are you about to get sacked or do you think the owner is about to sack you? Because let's be honest, at that stage it was relevant. And I know they'd only played six games, but it's relevant because two previous head coaches before him had lasted for six games and he seemed to be in that same sort of delicate area. We did, yes. Yeah.
Steve Canavan spoke here last year about the time the Blackpool was out.
Yes.
And there's a story that, for want of a better word, that the newspaper basically agreed to bury about the club sort of flexed their muscles and said, well, actually, you know, we'll give you a column from our captain once a week for the next couple of seasons as well. Has something like that ever happened at the
Not to that degree, although the paper have occasionally refused to run stories that I've written because they didn't think they were legally safe, and that's extremely frustrating because you check them, you double check them, and because you've written them, you naturally think, oh, it's fine, it's no problem, but clearly they have responsibility to look after the paper. We've certainly never traded anything negative for anything in return, and these days, I think it's more and more risky to do that because you're under so much more scrutiny from social media. Other people will pick up on stories. And whereas before, the Evening Post had a reach out into your local area around the city of Leeds, anyone anywhere in the world can read about it. And anybody in Leeds can equally read any newspaper anywhere else in the world. And other newspapers will run stories that you don't, at which point you would have to get on them anyway. So if you've got a story, you're best to do it. And no, we would never do that. I know Steve well, actually, and the funny story with Steve was that he reported on Blackpool for Football Club for years and years before deciding that he'd had enough and wanted to go into features. And his first job was to go around and knock on the door of a local drug dealer who threatened to blow his head off with a shotgun. So by the time he was back for his lunch break, he was thinking he might quite like to have gone back to Bloomfield Road. I think it is important, although I equally feel that what you're doing on a course here and the depth that you'll go into is, it would be difficult to find to any extent elsewhere, certainly in the realms of sports journalism. As I said earlier, I found it really odd that the NCTJ were making shorthand optional, because I would have thought that they would have been the last bastion for shorthand. And I can't think of many reporters that I work with regularly who would be happy to do without shorthand. So we studied, we went through NCTJ courses of shorthand at Sheffield University back in the late 90s. And from that point of view, it was extremely valuable, media law as well. And I still think they're as relevant now as they ever have been.
Thank you.
Statistics is a great example, because more and more newspaper articles, including ours, are based on statistics. And the analysis of players is so much more detailed now than it's ever been before. 10 years ago when I started this job, you'd have, even Prozone, even clubs themselves, didn't employ Prozone across the board in the way that they do now. So you would have no way of knowing how many individual clearances somebody like Pontus Janssen had made in one game, whereas now, by about 6 o'clock in the evening, you can find that on three or four websites. And the club obviously do their own detailed analysis, which is mostly kept private, but from time to time they will give you bits and pieces that might be of interest. So that is really the big shift in terms of detailed reporting. The one thing that is very prevalent these days, and the one thing that I and others are not overly keen on, is your five things listicles, five things we learned from. And as a colleague of mine on the Newcastle Chronicle said, over the course of a season, you find yourself learning about 1,300 things, which is really not that realistic. But again, it does seem to be the bread and butter of online websites. And if we're being honest, it's a bit of a make-weight for the fact that a lot of papers don't have enough staff to do anything better. Yeah, it was the local media in Newcastle, the Chronicle, the Journal, and the Sunday Sun. I think clubs are entitled to ban journalists, I honestly do, and I know there are some people who've campaigned to get the Football League to ban clubs from doing that themselves, to say to clubs you're prohibited from banning journalists. But I genuinely think that if you're criticising them to an extent that they can't cope with, then it is within the right to withdraw media facilities from you and to stop you attending press conferences and so on. The problem is that it's completely counterproductive, because if you've got an aggressive paper who've been aggressive with you, if you ban them, then they, like we did on the base, you have free rein to write and say what you like, which isn't to say that we don't write and say what we like anyway, but the gloves come off really. And I can't think of one scenario where banning a football club has been productive for a club or has worked. The papers that were banned in Newcastle last season hammered Ashley, hammered McLaren. That club were relegated at the end of the year. They're very much back in the fold now. They're very close to Benitez and working well with them. And they're top of the league by 3 or 4 points. It could be a coincidence, but I suspect it's probably not. Well, I'm a Heart and Midlothian fan, so I would like to cover them, although I always have nightmares about getting stuck in the backwater of Scottish football. But I think when you've covered a club for so long, certainly in England, you'd have no interest in moving to another club, because you have your contacts, you know how it works. And I think football writing, as much as the personalities and the people change, the nuts and bolts of it is the same. And it's nice to be able to cover a club that you have knowledge of, that you've got prior experience with. My German was never good enough for this, but I would always have loved to have gone to the Bundesliga, just for a change of scene and to cover a completely different game, but that won't be happening. Yeah, there is pressure for that, definitely. But I think you come to realise that you can't break every story, and you're not going to break every story. You are going to miss things that from time to time you think we should definitely pick that up, and there is no excuse for missing that, but that's the same with everybody. So you'll get your fair share, you'll miss others, and these days, as I said, the advantage the Evening Post had back in the 70s and the 80s was that they were up against the Nationals and the Nationals alone, but these days, Swedish papers write things about Janssen, Spanish papers write things about Pablo Hernandez. You've got a huge wealth of competition to fight against. So you do your best, you do what you can, but yeah, we definitely work under that pressure.
Is that it? Okay, right. Well, thanks a lot, Flo. That was very illuminating. Steve Canavan, interestingly, is now at UCLan.
He's
heading up their sports journalism program as well. So now he's run away even further from the journalism. But you very, very quickly work out that a life of an academic is no easier than a life of a writer.
No, I bet. Yes. Although nobody will threaten to shoot him.
Indeed. I'm external examiner at Sunderland and at UCLan, that's how I know that. Okay, so Phil is sticking around for about half an hour before he's got to shoot off to a press conference. So for those of you that needed to talk to him, I'd suggest you do that pronto. Please join me in thanking him for coming in today.